Thank you very much for that kind introduction. So I met Professor Page last night, and it was wonderful to hear another friendly accent. And we bonded immediately, and then discovered that we cheered for the wrong hockey teams. And so we can't be friends, alas. Thank you all for coming to hear the talk tonight. Chris, who is who's been a very gracious host while I've been here, told me this should be a talk for the general public, but also with lots of details for computer scientists. So I'm probably going to alienate the general public and bore the computer scientists, but so everyone will be equally offended by the end of the talk. So I hope I achieve that. Anyone know who this gentleman is? Don't look at the cursive at the bottom. It's William Whewell. He was a master at Trinity, philosopher, but really Renaissance man. He worked in biology, many, many disciplines. But I'm interested in him for his philosophy. He defined a concept called consilience. And he defined consilience as a convergence of evidence from multiple different fields, especially when it's the sciences and the humanities coming together to draw a conclusion. And Whewell's philosophy, when I encountered it later in my career, you know, I was still a very rigid mathematician at the time, profoundly influenced how I approached the rest of my career after that point. And in that, I've always been interested in interdisciplinary research, but this was a nice philosophical framework for thinking about where interdisciplinary research can go. And it's a very broad tent. Today, I'm going to be focusing on biomedical convergence, but yeah, I do participate in a lot of research in the humanities, you know, bringing together data analytics. I've done some stuff on Gregorian chant, which if you'd asked me 2 years ago, are you going to be working with scholars of Gregorian chant? I would have said no, but here we are. So I want to talk today about something slightly narrower than consilience, which is another C word, and this is Phil Sharp and his crew at MIT. Convergence. And so it's the same idea. It's the idea that the time has come in research where no one discipline, no one person can really push the bar forward. You know, the lone genius in the tower. In pure mathematics, there's still a few left, but even that dominance is ending. If you look at what Terry Tao has done recently with bringing big groups together to attack open problems, that's one of the last bastions of the lone wolf scholar is falling. So people in biology, in particular, molecular biology, have started to recognize this. And there was a nice article in the journal Science just a couple weeks ago where Phil and his crew were expositing their view of the future of research. And of course, it's very health and medical focused because Phil's a molecular biologist. And they have this nice chart for, you know, how molecular biology started, you know, discovery of DNA, very wet bench biology, you know, a molecular biologist didn't exist, and then all of a sudden they did, but they were at the bench doing stuff. And then at some point, we were generating a lot of data. This gene sequencing thing is hard to do by hand. You know, the very early alignments of gene sequences were done by writing things out on graph paper and manually aligning them. Bioinformatics became a thing, and so on and so forth. And by the time you get to the present day, you realize that you need a lot of different disciplines working together to push biology forward to the point where the top molecular biologists are saying, molecular biology isn't a monolithic discipline anymore. It's many, many people working together. So I'm going to take this framework, and I'm not going to talk about molecular biology, but I'm going to take the intellectual framework of convergence and apply it to one of the projects I've been working on in traumatic brain injury. So everything I'm going to talk about today is not my own research. It's research in which I'm one small cog in a big team. And Doug Fraser here is a pediatric intensivist, and I credit him with bringing the team together. He brought me onto the team. We were introduced by a mutual friend, physiologist up here, Kevin Shoemaker. And Kevin said, Doug's got some data and he really wants someone. I'm like, oh, I'm not a data analytics guy. I've got so many projects. But I met with Doug for coffee and he pitched this idea to me. I said, well, you know, I'm really busy. Maybe I'll get back to you. And he said, come down to the pediatric critical care unit. just for a morning, and see the patients I've got there. And so, okay, I'll do that. And you know, Doug's pretty shrewd. He knew that after you see that, after you see the families and the suffering, you leave thinking, okay, if there's some possible way I can make a tiny contribution here, I have to. So I immediately signed up after that. And it's been an incredibly rewarding experience. So I'm very thankful to Doug for manipulating me into joining this team. So we have physicians on the team because this is medical research and we work with patients. We have MR physicists. So these are physicists who are specialized in magnetic resonance and in particular magnetic resonance imaging. We have cellular and molecular biologists on the team. We have math and stats folks on the team, and I'm one of those. And we have our pet physiologist, who's Kevin up there in the corner. Why do we care about concussion in Canada? Well, we really like hockey in Canada, so thank you for introducing hockey right in the outset. And we do this to our young. So, yeah. So kids around the age of 4, if you really want to make it to the National Hockey League someday, you have to start very young. And so there's leagues all the way up, and they're playing, and there's a lot of accidents that happen in hockey. So this is the type of accident that happens. It looks like there's a lot of trauma there. There's also less accidental injuries that happen in hockey, and some of those can be even more impressive. Down here, the blade just barely missed. But there's a lot of hits to the head, and the head is not particularly well protected. You know, we have helmets there that are kind of for show and to prevent blood if a puck hits you in the face, but a lot of the trauma gets translated right through into the brain. Now, we're not the only ones who have problems here. Football also has a lot of problems. This looks like it's gonna hurt, and it looks like blunt force trauma. You know, this is perfect convergence, consilience of head and ball. Very dramatic. What happens in traumatic brain injury? And I want to focus mostly today on mild traumatic brain injury because profound traumatic brain injury is easier to detect. It's complex. We know some of the things that happen. So axonal shearing, your neuron has a long axon along which impulses propagate. And when you get hit in the head, some of those axons are sheared. And in some cases, bundles of axons connecting two regions of the brain are sheared from the force. They will regrow, they will reconnect, but they may not reconnect correctly. Or they may not reconnect at all. Demyelination. Important axonal tracts are covered in myelin, which is effectively an electrical insulator, which allows the impulses to travel faster. And since humans are real-time processing machines, we have to react to threats in real time. It's really important that we have fast communication between brain regions. So traumatic brain injury can also remove some of the myelin sheath. Neuroinflammation, which is just a fancy word for there's inflammation somewhere in the brain, and we don't understand how this localizes, we don't understand what the long-term consequences of this are all that well yet, and it's mostly a mystery. We can describe the symptoms, we can describe some of the outcomes, but the details of what's going on in the brain are not really well articulated at this point. Okay, so getting hit on the head is bad. We can probably all agree with that. You know, if I offered free hits in the head to the audience right now, there'd be few takers. Chris? Getting hit a second time while you're concussed is much more likely to be catastrophic than just getting hit in the head once. So if you get a concussion, that's bad. It can be debilitating. If you get a second hard blow to the head while you're already concussed and healing, that has a much, much higher probability of being a life-altering event. So in the context of athletes in particular, this is concerning. So these two ladies here, that's gonna hurt. Yeah, oh, I'm in the UK. Is that gonna lead to a concussion? And I'd love to tell you, oh, I've got an algorithm that says if there's this many newtons of force and this many newtons of force and they're oriented in this direction, yes, there'll be a concussion, otherwise, no, there won't. And I can't, because it's really a one-off. It depends on the particular physiologies and anatomies of those two soccer players. It depends on the rotational forces, the linear forces. There's a huge number of variables here. And just changing two people in an otherwise exact same situation, you could get different outcomes. So there's no really easy way to tell just by observing the event, are they concussed or not concussed? So when you ask this question, if you get the answer right, then you would remove them from play and give them therapy and make sure that they recovered before they went back. If you get the answer wrong, it could change their careers. So if you get the answer wrong on the side of, well, I'm gonna pull you out when you're not concussed, turns out the scout for the next league up was there that night and didn't get to see her play. Now her career's over. But if I get it wrong and put her back in the game and she gets hit again, maybe now her life changes forever because she has permanent cognitive or physical impairments. So the easy answer, I work with a lot of medical imagers, is let's do medical imaging. Imaging solves all of our problems, except the financial ones. But this is a relatively cheap imaging modality compared to what I'll show you later. This is a CT scanner, 3D x-ray. We take an x-ray machine, we rotate it around you, and we get a nice 3D image of what's going on in your head, or body, but in this case, head. Relatively cheap. Bad side is it exposes you to ionizing radiation. If you asked me if I wanted one of my daughters to have a CT scan, I'd have to be really worried before I said, yes, okay. It's a pretty significant amount of radiation. So you don't want to do it that often to people. But the healthcare system likes it because it's cheap. And the machines are cheap, so you can put them in almost every primary and secondary care facility. So here we have CT image of normal brain and a brain that has had a massive bleed here. This is not concussion. This is not mild TBI. This is a patient who will probably never recover. These are the kinds of patients that I saw in the critical care unit. This is a devastating injury. So when the injury is devastating, you can learn that with a CT scanner. But you can also learn that clinically just by looking at how badly off the patient is. These patients aren't walking and talking. If they're breathing on your own, you're lucky. Here is a CT scan of a normal patient and one with a fairly severe concussion. Any radiologists in the room? Anyone spot the difference? Yes, they're exactly the same image. And the point I'm trying to make is you can't see this on a CT scan. Most of the injuries we've talked about, neuroinflammation, sheared axons, demyelination, these things are micro changes that you're not gonna see at the macro scale. So CT, which is good for seeing really severe injury, is effectively worthless for mild to moderate injury. Mild to moderate just means the anatomy isn't that badly hurt. It doesn't mean that the consequences cognitively and behaviorally for the individual are mild or moderate. So we have to do something more sophisticated than this, or don't. We can look at something less sophisticated. So this is the SCAT-3, sports concussion something test. You get hit on the head, your coach pulls this out, your coach has been trained and goes through about 50-ish questions, and the big questions are you dizzy? Do you feel like you're gonna throw up? Do you have a headache? Does light bother you? Are you confused? And then there's several follow-up questions to sort of cross-check and make sure you're giving an honest answer. And how does this work? This was originally proposed by clinicians and developed over many years, and it looks like it works pretty well and has been impactful, but it's, you know, it's 50 questions, so you're sitting at the side of the pitch and the player really wants to get back in and the coach has other things to do and it's Little League, so it's just the coach. There's no one else to support. Are you really gonna carefully go through this? Maybe not. So can we do something better? So we looked at the SCAT-3, and again, the reason we're looking at this is because we wanna make an impact. We actually wanna make a difference. And if our solution to diagnosing concussion is difficult and expensive, it won't be implemented. This is a piece of paper. Can we ask fewer questions? You know, it would be amazing if I could ask you 5 questions and determine if you were concussed or not. That's extremely cheap. Can put that at the side of every Little League game, and we're all set. So the first thing we did was really very simple, principal component analysis. So all the computer scientists in the room will have seen this at some point. For those of you who aren't a computer scientist, the idea is, imagine I've got along this bottom axis here how much your head hurts, and on this top axis here, how much you feel like there's pressure in your head. So I just plot, I check this with 100 people who maybe have concussions, and I plot this, and I see there's this nice strong diagonal here. So it looks like these two things are really actually closely related. So did I have to ask 2 separate questions? Because it looks like there's actually only one underlying dimension of interest. This is just a little bit of noise here. Principal component analysis just says, well, let's take this data and rotate it down so that it lies right along this axis. And once I've rotated it, I can say, you know what, I'm just gonna throw this other axis away altogether. So if you do that with SCAT3 data from some of our hockey players, these are 12-year-old bantam Little League hockey players, and you ask, how many of these dimensions can I throw away? Because we've actually got 50 questions, so we've got a 50-dimensional space rather than a 2. How many can I throw away and still really get the gist of it? And you plot this little curve here, and you can see, really, the first 2 questions explain most of the variance in the data, and then you get diminishing returns as you go out. So if you just plot the first 2 against each other, the red dots here are the concussed, and the blue dots are the controls, and it's not perfect, but you can see concussed clusters over here, control clusters over here. So what this suggests is that if I could pick the right 2 questions, the mathematics tells me I should be able to do this with 2 or 3 questions, not 50. The trick is finding the right 2 or 3 questions, because the sleight of hand here is, when I rotated this axis around, instead of having nice clear questions like, does your head hurt, do you feel pressure, this axis is now 60%, how much pressure do you feel, 40%, how much does your head hurt, and that's not a helpful question. So actually developing the 2 or 3 questions to get there is a much more difficult problem than computer science can solve. It's for the clinicians. The other way of looking at this, and the way to turn this into an algorithm that's more sophisticated than what the SCAT3 currently does, is with the decision tree. So the way the SCAT3 currently works is you ask the questions, every question gets you a score, you add all those scores up, and if the number's over some threshold, you're concussed. You're gathering data that is way more interesting and specific when you're asking those questions than just boiling it down to a single number and a threshold. So we ask, can we build a decision tree? And what's the depth of that decision tree? So a decision tree, if you haven't seen one before, this is the Wikipedia example of a decision tree for, did you survive on the Titanic? So if you were a passenger on the Titanic, are you male, yes or no? If you're not male, you survived, pretty likely you survived compared to being a male. If you're a child, not so good. And then if you had siblings or parents on the ship, this also, number of siblings and parents, I think, determines whether you died or survived. So you just go down through this chart, ask these questions, and get this outcome. And you can build this tree, and in fact, whoever put this on Wikipedia did, from the actual data. From the data, this decision tree is one of the best decision trees for classifying who lived and who died on the Titanic. So we could do the same thing with our SCAT3 questions. And in fact, because the way we generate these trees from data has some stochastic elements to it, so some random elements, what we actually do is generate a forest of these things. So you got a bunch of decision trees, and maybe they all agree, but most of the time they don't. So they all have a different opinion, and you let them vote, and then you take the consensus. So we tried that with the SCAT3 data, and the decision tree is 95% accurate at getting the clinically correct diagnosis, which is quite good. And the decision tree also allows us to see, so in this forest of decision trees, how often are particular questions the critical deciding factor in deciding is this person concussed or not. And we can quantify that, and we do, and we see headache, head pressure, nausea, fatigue, feeling I'm in a fog, feeling I don't feel right, these are all very important. And then by the time you get down here to confusion, it actually isn't that important to question. And then the ones below this, I didn't even bother plotting. So again, this suggests that we can do quite well with a SCAT 3 that has many, many fewer questions, which makes it an easier instrument to deliver. So I've got a cheap, effective way for testing concussion. I don't need a sophisticated piece of equipment. I don't need an expert. I just need someone who can give a survey and type in data into a smartphone, and it'll run the decision tree. And so we're done. Problem solved. Any questions? So couple of questions that I have. Will young athletes honestly report? And so if you actually go into the field and you observe a SCAT-3 being applied, even to 12, 13, 14-year-old hockey players, they know the right answer to every single question, and they often give it. And it's even worse the older you get. You get into the 16, 17-year-olds, and they're looking at the ability to play Junior B hockey and actually make a career out of this. And so they lie. Because this is what I want to do with my life. I have one shot at making it to the big leagues. The scouts here tonight. I have to win this game. I have to be seen. Done. So this is a huge problem. So the survey is wonderful in principle, but in practice, human behavior sort of mitigates some of that wonderfulness. The other question we're really interested in, and it suffers from the survey suffers from the same problem it does in the initial diagnosis, is when can we put these athletes back in? How many people here do a sport of some sort? Running, cricket, stuff? Yeah, many. How many of you have been injured? This is certainly me. Did you enjoy being injured? There's few things in the world are sadder than an injured athlete. I went through a period of about 6 months where I couldn't run, and you can ask Mel, I was absolutely miserable. And so again, if you give me an opportunity to lie on some questions and get back to play, I'd be incented to do that. So we have to find something more objective. And so with this subgroup here, so this is our physiologist, a couple of our clinicians, and our math stats folks, we asked, can we do a blood test for concussion? Of course, we're not the first people to do this. You type blood test concussion into Google Scholar, you'll get 1,000 papers, probably more. The only thing we did a little bit differently is we approached the problem with a slightly more open mindset. The race in the past had been to find the biomarker for concussion. If this protein, this one particular protein is up, the person must be concussed. And we asked a slightly different question, and that worked out pretty well for us. But first, to give you an idea of how this works, we draw a blood sample. So not for everyone. Some people really don't like having blood taken. This would be unpleasant. But if you're worried about your future health, maybe you're willing to do that. We take a blood sample. We pre-process that. Largely, it's extracting the proteins and removing all the lipids and things we're not interested in. Bringing down here into the mass spectrometer. A mass spectrometer is a big machine that takes molecules and sprays them through a strong magnetic field. And then depending on how heavy that molecule is, its actual weight, the magnetic field will bend it more or less. And what you get out of the mass spectrometer is a spectrum that tells you, here's the mass to charge ratio of everything that was in the sample you just went through. Not quite everything. There's some stuff that's really hard to quantify, but a lot of it. Each one of these peaks corresponds to a particular molecule or family of molecules that came through the spectrometer, and there are very clever algorithms and databases now to turn this into a readout of everything that was present there. It's not perfect, there's stochastic elements to it, but it works very, very well. And how that works is, for our purposes today, black magic. It's a whole separate set of lectures on its own. But the important thing for us is I can turn this mass spectrum I get out of blood into a list of, here's the relative concentration of important molecules. And the important molecules for us are metabolites. Metabolites are molecules that are the byproducts of the daily housekeeping of your cells. So as your body is going about all of the things it needs to do, it produces various products, and those products of metabolism are metabolites. And when your body is in different states, those metabolic profiles that you produce look different. So our core question is, if I have a non-concussed individual and a concussed individual, so one on the top, one on the bottom, and I compare their spectra, do they look different, or is it just a big mess? So here we took our blood samples from some of our very brave 12-year-old hockey players, and we just asked that question. How similar are these spectra? How similar is the metabolic profile from concussed and controls? So what you see here is a heat map. Wherever the color is very bright and yellow, that means the profiles are quite similar. Wherever it's red, the profiles are quite different. This block up here is all concussed players. This block down here is all control. So these are kids with no concussion, still playing hockey, so same age group, same everything else is the same except that they don't have a concussion. And then there's kind of a group in the middle here. What we see is the concussed players are all very similar to the other concussed players in their metabolic profile. And they are most different from the control group that we know aren't concussed. So I was really happy when we saw this plot. Doug, my collaborator, showed this plot at a conference when he was giving a talk, and someone came from a drug company came up afterwards and said, can I get an enlargement of that to put over the headboard of my bed? Okay. So the only thing we did different than what everyone had been doing up to that point was, instead of saying, what's the marker for concussion? I mean, it would be nice if there was, right? If there was one protein, I can create a little ELISA kit and it's really cheap and fast for me to test that. We just said, okay, let's not just look at one, let's look at them all and see if there are statistically recognizable differences across this spectrum. And we see this right here. Now, it's not perfect. All the concussed are grouped together, controls are grouped together, which is great. And then we've got this group in the middle here where they're almost all concussed, but there's a group of control subjects in here. So, you know, the sensitivity isn't perfect, but this is a pretty crude way of measuring things too. It gave me enough hope that we should continue. That principal component analysis thing I talked about earlier, which we did with the SCAT3, we did something slightly different here. So, you know, again, the breadcrumbs for the computer scientists in the room, we used a technique called T-distributed stochastic nearest neighbor embedding. SNE was invented by my late friend Sam Royce and Jeff Hinton a number of years ago. We made some small modifications to it, but it's still the same core idea. It does the same basic thing as principal component analysis. It allows you to reduce the number of dimensions. It's just better at taking nonlinearities into account. The blue are my concussed players. The white are my non-concussed players. So when I plot them after this dimensionality reduction exercise, I can see, well, looks like there's a nice big cluster here, and there's a nice big cluster here, and hey, it looks like I can draw a line right between them. So the computer scientists are smiling because they know I'm gonna plug this into a support vector machine, linear SVM, immediately, and ask, can I tell from the spectrum who's concussed and who's not? So you do your little bit of machine learning, and the support vector machine, which is, you know, again, sounds fancy and mathematical, but is actually dead simple. It's just, can I massage the data in such a way that I can draw a straight line through it, and everything on this side of the line is a control, and everything on this side of the line is concussed? And you know, the mathematics are almost that simple. So it works really well, 92% accuracy, which is better than any other reported blood test for concussion at this point. Moreover, it also allows me to identify, just like we did with the tree feature selection, who are the most important molecules. If I'm going to do mass spectrometry, I get all 100 molecules. Well, it's close to 100, so I get 100 molecules, 100 metabolites, so I might as well work with the whole spectrum. But if you're trying to imagine doing something portable, a mass spectrometer, if you've seen one, is not particularly portable, but there is a group of engineers we're working with in the States who have developed a portable mass spec. Like if you're really beefy, you can move this thing around to fear. And it has a much more limited range. So we're optimistic that even with the limited range there, we might be able to do something.
Is that 92% on the training data or on the predictions on seeding?
So this 92%, we did cross-validation on it. So yeah, the data set was too small for me to reserve. So this was cross-validated. It wasn't leave one out. I think it was threefold cross-validation. So not perfect, but small data set. And honestly, my expectation going into this is we get nothing. Nothing would work, because it never does, right? That's, how many of you are doing research right now? It never works, does it? That's the great thing about research, is you bang your head against the wall, and then the one time it does work, you spend another 3 weeks thinking, okay, I must have screwed up the code somewhere, right? Like, this is actually working. This isn't supposed to happen, especially not for something this interesting. So the blood test, it looks like it works. We've had a lot of interest in it. I've achieved one of my life dreams. There was an article in the Globe and Mail, which is sort of like the Canadian version of maybe the Guardian, and they did an article on our blood test, and it was on the front page of the sports section. So I get to tell people now, one time I was on the front page of the sports section of the Globe and Mail. And we've had quite a bit of interest from various groups who have people getting hit in the head frequently. We got a patent out of it. There's a paper in Metabolomics, and there's a really interesting community being built around that. I don't think it's a one-size-fits-all. I don't think this is a huge, major breakthrough. I think it's an interesting iterative step. None of the techniques I used there were super sophisticated. None of them really required an expert-level computer scientist. They just required someone who had a little bit of knowledge and said, I'm interested in collaborating with you. And as a group, we decided to think differently about the problem. And instead of chasing the molecule, we looked at spectra of molecules and compared those. So now the really expensive one. Mass spec isn't too bad. It's about $100 to do the mass spec. The algorithm, you know, the support vector machine can be run on an iPhone. So all of the expenses in doing the lab work. So $100 per sample, that's actually not terribly expensive in the medical context, but it's not something you're gonna take every kid who, oh, maybe that hit was a little bit hard. This one's even more expensive, but this one will help us get at why. Of concussion. So you can see I've brought the medical magnetic resonance imaging experts with me here, and I've promoted Kat, who is Ravi's PhD student, to center collaborator here, because this is really her work. She's the one driving this. I'm out of range of the, there we go. We're very lucky at Western to have one of a handful of 7 Tesla, so really high magnetic field, magnetic resonance imaging systems, and it's dedicated 100% to research. So this allows us to do spatial and temporal resolutions that are completely impossible with the typical clinical scanners. So a clinical scanner field strength will usually be about 1.5 Tesla. If you're in a newer hospital, state of the art, it might be 3 Tesla. 7 Tesla is, you know, obviously much better. There are other problems that come with high field strength, including expense. But you know, we're gonna take advantage of the facilities that we have available to us. How does magnetic resonance imaging work? Well, it turns out there's a quantum property of every atom called spin. And the simple way to think about this is not, I mean, it's not quite what's going on, is like a top spinning around. If you take a top and you spin it, it spins around and there's a clear axis around which it's spinning. If you take a random group of protons just floating around in water, so hydrogen atoms, they're spinning around all different axes. It'll just cancel out. But if I put them in a strong magnetic field, the stronger the magnetic field, the faster this will happen, they will all tend to line their axis of rotation up with the magnetic field. So you've got this really strong magnetic field pulling in one direction. That's what this is for. That's a really strong electromagnet. Superconducting electromagnet. All of your protons line up, well, not all of them, statistically significantly large number of them line up, just in case there's a physicist in the room, I gotta be really careful here, line up, and then I hit those protons with exactly the right frequency of RF energy, so electromagnetic radiation coming in, and that knocks them all 90 degrees over. So I take all of the ones that are lined up, and I knock them 90 degrees over, but the magnetic field's still there. So after I've knocked them over, they're all gonna wanna precess back towards the magnetic field, and they kind of sing at RF back. And I record that, and from that, I can determine how much freedom of movement those particular hydrogen atoms had. So if they're sitting in a glass of water, they reorient really, really quickly. If they're in a dense tissue matrix, it may be very hard for them to reorient, so that's gonna happen a lot slower. And that basic principle allows me to generate contrast images here. So you can see areas that are dark and areas that are quite white. And this is a very nice picture. This is completely ethical because it's my brain you're seeing there, faults and all. But you can produce these really nice high resolution images. And when you talk about magnetic resonance imaging, that's what most people think. This is me and one of my students looking at her brain, which she said was okay for. And you typically think of these nice high resolution structural imaging, and that's what MR is for. And certainly it's very good for that, but that's not quite what we're interested in, right? One of the consequences of concussion include consequences to cognition and processing. And so I'm actually interested in the dynamics of the brain. This is a static anatomical picture. And we saw with the CT, when we were doing the CT scanning, it was only the really, really damaged brains that we picked up on the CT. We can pick up more subtle damage on a structural MR image, but most concussion is, you know, clinically present. So someone will, I feel like I'm in a fog, I'm having trouble remembering things, I feel like I have to vomit. All of those things will be true, but nothing would show up on an MR scan. So I'm not particularly interested in anatomy and structural, because again, this is just way too high level. If I could go into the brain and look at the micro level, if I could see individual blood vessels, I might be able to tell something from imaging, but that would require taking the skull off, which has problems associated with it. That in the case where you had that big giant bleed, that is one of the fixes, is relieving the intracranial pressure by actually removing the skull. And in pediatric cases, that sometimes works, but the neurosurgeons that I've talked to said in an adult, if you get to the point where you're removing the skull to relieve pressure, survival rate is very close to zero. So again, we're working at the less severe end of the spectrum. So we use a technology called functional magnetic resonance imaging. And this is based on a very simple principle. And the principle is supply and demand. If a particular part of the brain is more active at a particular point in time, it's gonna need more fuel. And the fuel is oxygen for respiration delivered via the blood. And so what if we took someone while they were performing a task, for example, and looked at how oxygenation levels changed in the blood. And very fortunately, there are particular pulse sequences for MR that allow you to detect how oxygenated blood is at a particular point in the brain. So we do that. We ask this question, how oxygenated is the blood here versus here? And you get these really beautiful images. So when fMRI was first starting in the early 90s, if you could produce one of these images, you could get a paper in the very top journals, Nature, Science, because they're, wow, look, brain maps. In this particular case, someone was taken and given a very simple task where all they had to do was tap their fingers. So tap your fingers now, stop tapping your fingers. Tap your fingers now, stop tapping your fingers. And what we see is that the biggest change in oxygenation and blood flow during that task is in motor cortex. And that's exactly where you'd expect it, because they're doing a motor task. And so there ensued a long period after the 90s of navel gazing and infighting about, well, is this really measuring what we think it is? And the short answer is yes. The long answer is it's actually really rather complex. But for our purposes, it is actually a very good proxy for activity in the brain and has now been proven so. And there's some really beautiful series of experiments by Nicholas Logothetis, where he combined electrophysiology, where you're actually doing electrical recordings in primates with fMRI, and showed it actually is pretty much doing what we think it's doing, but we do have to be careful in how we interpret it. So this is a good tool for us, for our concussed patients, to try to understand how the concussion or the mild traumatic brain injury is changing the dynamics, the processing in their brain. Rather than a task, especially if someone's already concussed and confused, you don't want to give them a really complex task, we're going to do something called resting state fMRI, where we just place people into the magnet and say, rest. That this works at all is actually kind of amazing, because when you put someone in there and say, don't think about anything, just relax, people are immediately going to start thinking about things and reflecting, but it seems like people are fairly heterogeneous, or homogeneous rather, in what they think about when you place them in the scanner. For a while, people were tacking resting state scans onto, they'd do a bunch of experiments, and the person would be in the magnet for 2 or 3 hours, and okay, now we're going to do 10 minutes of resting state. And it's really, I kind of have to pee state fMRI, because you've been in there for 3 hours and you can't move, and you're reflecting on that. But it's very, very easy. It's sort of a low-hanging fruit, no task design, nothing to worry about. And in our case, it worked pretty well. So now I need to talk about graphs. As a normal person, when I say graph, you probably think of something that looks like this. But as a mathematician, this is what I think of when I think of a graph. So graphs are really nice mathematical objects. There's a rich literature going back centuries of theorems that we can build on and allow us to infer things about them and understand how they operate. Dynamic graphs, where the graph is changing, is a relatively newer area of study, but again, still a fairly rich literature around it. And this is the ideal mathematical tool for modeling when you have things and relationships between things. So the things we represent with the circles there that we call a node or a vertex, depending on who you trained with. And then the connections between them are called edges. So each one of these nodes represents a thing, and each one of these edges represents some kind of relationship. The classic example in the modern world is a social network. So if each node is a person, and their friends on Facebook, then I put an edge between them. And just by building that graph, I can learn a lot about individuals in the graph and about the society as a whole that generated that graph. So graph theory, and also called network theory, again, depending on whose papers you're reading, has been applied to all sorts of different areas. Social networks, the internet, connections between computers on the internet, power grids, which look remarkably different than social networks. I mean, you don't need a degree in discrete topology to see the structure here is quite a bit different than this one. Protein-protein interaction networks, structural networks in the brain, and the one we're interested in is functional networks in the brain. Why are graphs interesting? Because I can query them for properties. And in my case, if I'm interested in understanding concussion, I can build a brain graph for someone who is resting and not concussed, and someone who's resting and is concussed, and try to figure out how are these things different. What kind of metrics would I use for asking that question? Well, the really simple one is degree. So let's go back to our social network analogy. This person here is very well connected. They've got 4 whole friends. It's a small graph. This person over here, relatively more isolated, likewise, and I can just count the number of connections, and that already tells me a lot. If I'm thinking about these as brain areas, each one of these brain areas, and then if they're communicating with each other, I draw a line between them. This is a brain area that's communicating with a lot of other brain areas, and this one's communicating with relatively few. In a more complex graph, though, just the number of connections you have may not be very interesting. You may still be kind of an outsider in the graph. Maybe you've got a lot of connections, but it's just you and lots of one-off connections, and you're not between a lot of people. So there's this concept of betweenness, which says if I try to get from this person to this person, what are all the paths I can take? There's 2 there. And I do that for every pair of people in my graph, and then I count how many of those paths that are the shortest paths between 2 people go through a particular node. And that's a complex algorithmic way of saying how much do you sit between any two nodes in the graph. If I removed this node, it doesn't really change much about the social landscape of this graph. But if I remove this node, now to get from here to here, I have to go all the way around here. So this node may be somehow more important. And transitivity is getting closer to a mesoscale property of the graph. And the question you would ask in a social network is, if I'm friends with you and you're friends with her, what's the probability that we're also friends with each other? And so you often see transitivity in social networks, but not always. So how do I get from functional magnetic resonance imaging data to graphs? Well, each chunk of the brain that I'm scanning with my fMRI machine will give me a nice time series. And I can go right down to the level of an individual voxel, which is just the 3D version of a pixel, or I can take a larger chunk of the brain, and that's a parameter I can play with. But however large my field of view there, what I get out of my fMRI study is, here's how the oxygenation level of the blood changes over time. So I pick this for one area of the brain, and then I take it for another area of the brain, and the question I'm asking is, how similar are those two time series? So we did this resting state thing, and how much does the blood level change in this area of the brain look like this area of the brain? And the hypothesis is that if they're communicating, if their function is strongly linked, those time courses should be more similar than if they're completely disparate. And so I build a graph. The brain regions I'm interested in become the nodes in the graph. And then I check and say, how similar are these things? And I'm not going to go into the details of that. That's a very deep rabbit hole, and there's lots of different ways of doing it. But honestly, one that works well and is very simple is Pearson product moment coefficient. So just plain old Pearson correlation. You wouldn't think it would, but it actually does work very well. But there are much more sophisticated ways of quantifying how similar this is to this. And they all end up with relatively the same result, which is good. So if there's any people in the room doing machine learning and modeling, when you use multiple different techniques and they all give you the same result, that means your data is speaking for itself, rather than you've optimized a particular pipeline to get you the result that you decided a priori was the one you should get. That's bad. So if this result, how similar is this to this, is above some threshold, then I add an edge to my graph. Now the question of some threshold is one of the favorite ones. So this is where, you know, I collaborate with people, and sometimes, like in the blood work stuff, there was really no heavy lifting, sophisticated mathematics to be done, but it was still an interesting project, and I really enjoyed it. And we in the academy need to be more open and honest about encouraging people to do projects where, you know, so what if your particular domain didn't get a new unit of knowledge? You contributed to another domain. Because the way we evaluate each other, especially as faculty members right now, is, well, how much independent research did you do, right? So if I submitted that original blood concussion stuff to a computer science journal instead of a metabolomics journal, they'd say, oh, well, this isn't computer science. And ultimately, that's a very narrow and damaging attitude. Because you do these things, and sometimes you don't get to do new computer science, but sometimes you do. So when it came to this question of thresholding edges, there was a lot of really bad ideas in the literature when I sort of got drawn into this project several years ago now. And I said, okay, there's got to be a right way to do this. And it took about a year, but trying to find a principled way to do this thresholding, I ended up going way back to neutron scattering experiments and Eugene Wigner's analysis of those, and random matrix theory ended up being the right way to do this. And I didn't know much random matrix theory, but I got to the point where I was like, okay, I'm pretty sure there's theorems here I can use. So I got to learn random matrix theory, got to prove a couple theorems, and there are others in the neuroscience community who would say, oh, that's way, way too difficult. You don't need to do that. But it was really fun for me to, as math geek, to get to do some math geeky stuff. So I use random matrix theory to decide if the threshold is significant or not. If you want the details, I'm happy to talk to you after the lecture. But again, Chris told me general public, so I don't want to bore people to death. It's less exciting than I make it sound. What I've got now is a graph. Each node in my graph is a proxy for a physical brain region. And actually, you know, as a computer scientist, I really don't care about where these things are physically embodied in the brain. That's a neuroanatomy problem. I'm just interested in computation and dynamics, but the neurologists are very interested in where it is in the brain because that's how they see the world. So, okay, so we'll spatially embed each one of these nodes. And if the nodes have activity patterns over a length of time, say 10 minutes, that look very, very similar, I draw an edge between them. I do some processing, and then I plot a metric such as degree betweenness. And then I plot that right back onto the brain. Again, I only care about the graph metrics, so node betweenness, and the neurologists want to see it back on the brain, so we plot it back on the brain. Here's baseline. So these nodes are very connected. This is sort of, you know, superior temporal stuff here. These nodes are less connected. Post-concussion, you don't need to be a neuroscientist or a neurologist to see there's massive changes here. And the most interesting change is here. There's this big prefrontal decrease. And this fits with the earlier narrative when we were talking about the mechanism of injury, the pathophysiology of TBI. You know, this axonal shearing happens, neuroinflammation, connections are being broken. And the graph theoretic analysis and MR analysis suggest to us that, yeah, connections are being broken specifically to prefrontal areas. So if you've taken some psychology and some neuroscience, you know that the prefrontal areas of the brain, neocortex, are the newest areas of the brain. They're most pronounced in primates. And I'm on really thin ice here with getting back to phrenology. But if I take out frontal lobe, you will have very large difficulties with executive function, planning, making decisions, judging things. You can imagine in a concussion, if the long fiber tracts from back in the brain to the front of the brain are the ones that are damaged, it would make sense that you would find yourself confused and you'd feel like you were in a fog and demyelinated, so communication happens slower or not at all. And then 3 months post-concussion, that's actually cleared up, but there's something else going on here. So is this a compensatory mechanism? There's more questions than there are answers right now. There's no published paper to go with this. This is actually a composite. Again, I skipped over all the details of the stats and how we do this. This is a composite over, I think, 17 different concussed players. So this is sort of the consensus changes that have happened over all of those. And so the severity would range from sort of moderate to severe. If it was a very mild concussion, it probably didn't get reported. The player probably said, yep, fine, coach. And again, that's part of the problem. So what's interesting here isn't that, okay, I can plug a patient into an MR scanner and say, hey, you're concussed, or no, you're not concussed, because plugging a patient into an MR scanner, now we're talking between $400 and $1,000 versus $100 versus $50. It's too expensive. But this imaging modality allows me to start interrogating why we see the clinical impact and the behavioral phenotypes that we do in concussion. This is another nice little plot where I've just taken a bunch of brain areas, and I won't go through all of them. If you're a neuroscientist, you'll know what they are. If you're not, they just look like a jumble of acronyms. It's a lot like being a computer scientist. And what I've drawn here is, what Kat has drawn here, is any two areas that have changes in connectivity in these graphs have a little line drawn here in this nice chord plot. So we can see that most areas don't have changes between them, but there are some areas where the changes in functional connectivity are significantly different. And so this gives us a place to do further study. So why is it that these areas are experiencing different functional connections? And if you actually go and look at the neuroanatomy and talk to the neuroscientists who really understand this, what we're seeing is differences in functional connectivity between areas that are quite far apart from each other in the brain. Areas that are close and local to each other, we don't see much change in concussion. Areas that are far apart, especially along this caudal rostral axis here, so really areas that are really far to the front and really far to the back, are having changes in connectivity, which again is consistent with a mechanism of injury, that is, there's these long cables of axons in the brain, and when your brain gets hit, they get sheared and damaged. So it really looks like a wiring problem. Final bit, and I'm bringing in yet more collaborators here. So this is a little project we worked on a couple years ago. Jingyun Chen, who's a former postdoc, he's at NYU now. Heather Carlson, who's a former RA in Geneva now. And Rodri Cusack, my collaborator, who's at Trinity Dublin. We built a real-time graph theoretic MR system. And the reasons for doing this are complex, and I'm not sure I'd do it again because I'm a mathematician and knew nothing about real-time systems before I did this. Now I'm terrified of real-time systems. we take the MR scanner, we put the patient in the MR scanner, we do the scanning, we do the pre-processing. There's a lot of pre-processing that has to happen, right? You can imagine if the patient's in the magnet and then moves their head like this, what I was calling voxel 37 is now something completely different, so there's gotta be motion correction and registration. Run it through an IBM Streams-based program that we wrote, and that generates all of the graphs and connections in real time and allows, so real time here is plus or minus 2 seconds, it's not hard real time, there's real time people in the room, so I have to be careful. Gives a display back to the clinician. Prior to the system we built here, this was done by bringing the patient in, scanning them, a postdoc would take the data back, do the pre-processing, and that would take about a week, and then a week later they'd get around to doing the graph theoretic analysis, and 3 weeks later you might have a meeting with the clinician you were collaborating with, and the clinician said, this isn't really a useful tool, and it requires massive amounts of human intervention. So we changed this to a tool where there's no human intervention required, and I'm gonna show you what this looks like. So this is my brain worrying about systems integration problems. Each dot here is a region in my brain, and each line between two dots is these two brain regions are connected at this point in time. And you can see the graph isn't static. It's evolving over time, and it's changing. You see some nice clusters, and then the clusters will go apart. It's actually it kind of breathes. The clusters fall apart and then go back together. So this is obviously operating on canned data from a scan made a few years ago, but this can actually happen in real time, and what the clinicians wanted wasn't, you know, they're like, oh, that graph's really cool, but that's not a useful tool for clinical diagnoses. So if it loads, we can pick any metric that's of interest to the clinician. Here I'm just picking average degree in the whole graph and plot that along the bottom there. And what that does is allow the clinician at a glance to say, okay, is this value within what I would consider normal, or is this abnormal? And very quickly, you know, within about 5 or 6 minutes, a clinician can decide, okay, this study's giving me useful information, or this isn't. And now that really expensive MR that costs between $400 and $1,000 Canadian, I don't know what that is in pounds because the rate keeps changing. I don't want to make any political statements, but yeah, the Brexit thing has made my trip here much cheaper than it otherwise might have been. So we've got this nice plot here, and the clinician can quickly decide, okay, this isn't working, and instead of an hour-long scan that got processed manually over 2 weeks, it's all being done in real time, and it takes 5 or 6 minutes, and you can pump many, many more patients through. It's less agony for the patients. You can imagine for a non-compliant patient, this would be a really, really tough thing to do. I don't even like going in the magnet. I'm kind of claustrophobic, and when I'm in the magnet bore, I'm really claustrophobic, but I do anyways. And you can see these things change over time. But this gives us a much faster and then ultimately cheaper way of doing these diagnostics. So what we hope is that on the MR side, we can use this technology with what Kat has found in the realm of graph changes in the concussed patients and use it to really quickly diagnose concussion. And this would be in cases where the blood test was inconclusive or it was much more severe, because it's still more expensive than just doing a blood test. But there's some hope there for this actually being financially tractable from a healthcare standpoint. And again, it's cool to learn new things even when they horrify you. So not being an expert in real time and understanding this isn't real time, this is soft real time. Jingwen and I and Heather and I were working on this, and IBM, who is funding some of the research, said, we really want to do a live demo. Can you come to Toronto and give a talk and have a scan of someone's brain who's back in London? So I'm from London, Ontario, not the good London. No, I love my town, it's just not the same. who's back in London in your magnet. And I wanted to say no, and one of our collaborators said, yes, of course. So that's why that graph was of me stressing out about getting the system integration to work. We literally got it to work the night before the live demo. And I won't lie, I had the canned version ready to go just in case the live demo didn't work, but it actually worked. Second most amazing experience of my career. What can we take from all of this? Everything I've talked to you about tonight would not have happened, would have been completely impossible if just any one of us, or even really any pair of us, worked on it. None of this research would have happened. There wouldn't have been the intellectual framework to ask the right questions. There wouldn't have been the leadership. There wouldn't have been the people with the expertise to bring all these diverse threads together to make these contributions. And again, these are not huge life-changing contributions. These are small steps in the march of the research endeavor, but they're steps that wouldn't have been taken without a large team and a strong leader bringing that team together. So we have a little bit more understanding in what's going on in the brain and potentially a diagnostic tool from magnetic resonance imaging. We have a blood test that actually looks like a surprisingly promising diagnostic tool for concussion, and we've now changed the thought patterns in the literature, right? Those of you who are training to be a researcher, one of your most important goals isn't what have I achieved as a researcher, it's how can I influence my community? And so we've influenced our community to start thinking about spectra of metabolites instead of just the search for the one holy grail metabolite, and that's something I'm really proud of. And with the SCAT3, we've shown that you can probably make that shorter, but I don't know how. As a theoretical computer scientist who's published more than one non-constructive proof of existence, I can live with that. But it does suggest that there's a lot of ways to optimize the SCAT3, but also that the SCAT3 works really well modulo the players giving you the correct answers. But if they're not giving you the right answers, then the blood test always works. So this goes back to Ruel and his concept of consilience and bringing multiple threads together and how that can provide insights and intellectual leaps that are impossible to achieve with any single thread, with any single area of expertise alone. And this time I really am done. Thank you very much.
Going back to the blood test and the support vector machine with the 92%, I would be very concerned about a test that didn't pay a lot of attention to confusion matrix.
Yeah.
Can you tweak the support vector machine so that you minimize the type 2 errors? In other words,
Yeah.
So and did you do that?
The confusion matrix here isn't all that interesting because it's binary,
mm-hmm.
right? So we could just do something like an ROC curve. I put 92% up there, and anyone who's familiar with clinical trials knows, that's a disaster, that's worthless.
right?
Because 92% sounds great until you realize that means that if I see 100 patients, 8 of them are called wrong.
Right, but you'd rather get 92 that maybe had 10 of them that weren't and
yes.
pull them off the field.
So it's a do I want type 1 or type 2 error type mm-hmm. situation. And you can handle that by modifying parameters in the SVM or using a different technique. So I put an SVM up there just because it's really simple. We tried this with a few different ML techniques, and they all got to sort of a convergent result, which is what you want, because
yeah.
then it's the data speaking, not okay. your particular technique.
Really nice seeing all of the, I mean, I got your point. I see how all those pieces fit together. It reminds me very much of what my doctor father talked about. There's no person that can be a Renaissance man anymore.
No.
So what we have to do is develop Renaissance teams.
Renaissance teams, I love it.
I was wondering, your graphs here, they seem to be undirected. So the
yes.
question is, are they inherently undirected? Or I sense that there could be perhaps a temporal dimension there.
Indeed.
Definitely directed.
So that's an excellent question that created quite a fist fight in the literature about 4 years ago. So are the graphs directed? My graphs are undirected because I have two time series, and I want to answer the simple question that I feel I can answer in a principled way, which is how similar are these two? If I'm going to add direction, I'm implicitly adding causality into the equation. So can I say that this change over here was caused by this change over here? I wish I could. And so there are people who have used techniques from econometrics like Granger causality to do this. And then there are other people who have shown using gold standard data and synthetic data that this almost always gets it wrong. And then there are other people who have shown, no, it almost always gets it right. And so there's a really heterogeneous set of opinions in the literature right now. I've chosen to stick with undirected graphs because I feel that's principled. Could we maybe infer causality? Yes. Is Granger causality the right tool? I don't personally think so, and I don't know that we have the right tool to do that. And I don't know that the temporal resolution of fMRI is sufficient to do that. If we were working with EEG or MEG data, I'd feel a lot more comfortable moving in that direction, but fMRI is pretty coarse, spatially and temporally.
Well, but one issue would be, if you're using any notion of similarity there, then the fact that if the graphs were originally inherently directional,
yes.
and you're collapsing it,
yes.
then your definition of similarity is not as accurate as it could have been.
Absolutely. If I had access to that causal information, two graphs that look identical, undirected, may be incredibly different when you have that causality information adding directed edges. I don't think I can get that. I mean, mathematically, I can work with those fine, but I don't know that they reflect the underlying physiology.
Yes, ask you a question now.
Yeah.
I have three questions. The first one is when you talk about use the blood test, all the biomarkers, are they unique to the concussion? Because like the brain grow tumors, they also have most of the symptoms you list as features.
Yes.
Have the same features.
Yes.
So this is one thing difficult. Are they independent to this diagnosis? Secondly, how did you choose your control group? When you mentioned that the myelinations,
mm-hmm.
this happens, this development,
indeed.
Happen different in different age.
Yes.
For example, before 2 years of baby, none of them.
Yeah.
And after 50 or 60, they have a dementia, some
yeah.
people, and also have the same symptoms. So this control group must connect to the age.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the last one, you mentioned about the shift of the brain cause the problem. I don't think this is very important because even the brain shift, a little bit shift internally, it doesn't change the condition profoundly. The most important thing is the redistribution of the cerebral spinal fluid
okay.
inside the brain. When something hit here and then all this leave the vacuum and all the this fluid maybe go to the deep brain, and then this can cause the death of the neurons and also interrupts the connection of the synaptic connection. Is it correct? So all these things need to be considered.
I certainly wouldn't argue with you on the last point. So of that slide I showed, again, remembering I'm trying to speak to a general audience and keep it simple, the most important line was complex and heterogeneous. So the effects of TBI are in some cases fairly mild and subtle, in some cases more severe, but it's incredibly complex, and the mechanism, the pathophysiology is not well understood, and that's the only concrete answer I can give you. So the redistribution of CSF, coup contra coup injuries, all of this plays a part. So I'm oversimplifying greatly when I'm focusing just on axonal shearing, but it's an easy story to tell in a 1 hour talk. But you're quite right. It's an incredibly complex mechanism of injury.
Just think about an open stance and changing positions.
And on the control groups, they are hockey players, the exact same age, same league, same teams, who have not had a concussion. So they're the closest match controls we can possibly get. But the comment on myelination, of course, yeah, if I were comparing 3-year-olds to 15-year-olds, very, very different results.
So am I right in thinking you're using the SCAT-3 as a sort of reference criterion for concussion?
I'm not. So we tested the SCAT-3. We tested everything against a clinician's diagnosis. So the diagnoses were all made by either sports medicine clinicians or intensivists. And that's our gold standard.
Okay.
And they themselves will admit, maybe you shouldn't be using us as a gold standard. But there's a lot to be said for experience. Most of them, and especially their senior nurses, will say, I don't need to do a SCAT-3. I can look at someone and talk to them for 30 seconds and know if they're concussed or not.
Is there a risk that there's types of concussion which don't show up in the typical way, but are equally dangerous when you go back out on the field?
I would be surprised if the answer weren't yes, but not being a clinician, I don't want to answer that with authority. I think if we can identify a somewhat deterministic means of getting some of the spectrum of mild traumatic brain injury, that's a good first step. But it is a spectrum. So there was the very severe where you saw the bleed, and we can see that with radiology, all the way down to extremely subtle and mild, and very likely they would be at increased risk of a second injury, but they don't know that because it's so mild that it's subclinical. And how do we deal with that? Ban people from getting out of bed.
To be fair, it was a great talk, and I was inspired by the fact that you said, well, there's this front-to-back severing seems to be happening. Well, what about side-to-side, which presents totally differently? And equally long distances and equally potentially severe. But, you know, I wouldn't have had that thought if you hadn't gone so far. So.
So outside of the sports context, some of the best predictors of who gets post-concussion syndrome are actually patient features like age, whether intoxicated and things like that.
Yes.
Have you thought about trying to integrate things like the mechanism of injury and patient characteristics in order to improve how sensitive your tests are at detecting concussion?
So absolutely. So if we're using this in a tertiary care center, those would all be the types of data that you'd want to bring in because you'd have that in the clinical history. I'm not so interested in working in that particular environment because the clinicians already know. By the time they see someone, they don't need an app. They don't need me to help them make the diagnosis. Once you're in A&E, you're going to be well taken care of, and no support is needed. I'm more interested in the very front line where it's at the side of the pitch, the injuries just happen, and a coach with no expertise, potentially, has to make a decision. And so we're interested in supporting that. And there, those variables are going to be much more controlled. But yeah, of course, if you're thinking about doing this much more broadly, I'd want to know age. I'd want to know hydration state. I would want to know if you've been drinking. And all of these factors are hugely informative in terms of whether you're concussed or not and your prognostic.
Yep.
Yeah.
You mentioned that with the football example, that just sort of knowing the force and the angle and so on wasn't enough to make a sort of estimation, but isn't that possible if certain, say, accelerometers or whatever, and with a suitable sort of prior base of data to get a model which might not be great, but would be better than a potentially dishonest younger athlete in terms of having that sort of first estimate of are they potentially concussed or not? I mean, obviously, it's flawed, but is it not less flawed than believing a child's opinion to be correct and honest?
Absolutely. I'm glad you asked that. Our football team, which is an American football team, we have a soccer team too, now has all of their helmets instrumented, and part of the team I showed you here are working on analyzing that data, and at the same time, we're doing cognitive testing. And there's some really eye-opening results there over a season of American football, which is about the most dangerous sport from this standpoint, because you have people whose whole job is to ram their head into someone else who's also, so the accelerometers are there, and we're gathering that data, and we're seeing, I agree with you in principle, it should be possible, but we actually want to gather that data and see how well these two things correlate. And we're also in talks with one of the National Hockey League teams. The owner happens to be really interested in biomedical type things and maybe getting access to, which would be fantastic, because those guys take some pretty brutal hits, and that would be an incredible data set to have. But that one I can't guarantee I'm going to get. That's just, pie in the sky.
I'm a member of the general public. Can I just make a layman's comment? Last June, I fell off my bike. I banged my head. I was wearing a helmet. I got back on my bike, didn't think anything about it. 2 months later, I was rushed into Hull Royal Infirmary for emergency surgery. So you don't have to play sport to actually get an injury. And the message I'd like to pass on is that if you look into it, the cycle helmet is designed to prevent fractured skulls, but it's not very good at that. It's no good at all at preventing concussion. So the lesson is, wear a helmet for what it can do for you, but be careful.
I agree with you 100%, because I'm a cyclist. I know what a cycling helmet looks like. It's rigid, and all it does is transfer the force from the blow right into your skull, where it's absorbed by the brain. And the newer ones are designed to crush and to crack, but the materials aren't perfect yet. And so the more rigid that is, the more all of that force gets pushed right into the brain, and we get the very heterogeneous mechanisms of injury. So,
I just add another point to that, which is the symptoms can take weeks or months to become apparent. So
yes.
If anybody has a bang on the head, if you start getting symptoms, get them checked out. If you start
absolutely
lose dexterity or anything like that, don't hesitate.
That bears repeating, because the microphone wasn't on. If you've hit your head and you start experiencing any symptoms that you think might be related to that, go see a physician. This is not the type of thing you want to say, it'll be fine. It may well, but it may not. And if it's not, it's critical that you get care as soon as you can.
I'm a nurse and a rugby player, and I'm really glad this research is going on, but when am I going to be able to practically blood test my girls on the pitch every time they hit each other?
Define practical.
I'd really love it if I could do it just as easily as I test someone's blood sugar. That'd be perfect.
I agree with you 100%. Doing it as easily as testing blood sugar, with the test we've got in hand right now, that's not going to happen.
Please.
We may be able to create a small mass spectrometer the size of a large toaster that would be able to do this. But that's... right now, that's prospective research. All I can tell you is if you take the blood sample and send it into a lab that can do mass spec, you can read our paper and you can apply those analytics today. So we can do that right now. But in terms of being able to do it right at the side of the pitch, I wish I could give you more optimism, but I'm conservative. So I'm going to say, I don't know. We're working on it. It's been a couple days, so I'm doing okay.
Thank you very much for participating, and let's thank Mark again for a very...
Thank you.